Good morning, everyone. I'm glad to see you all here this morning. It is a beautiful fall day. Hopefully, sunrise this morning. It was exceptionally pretty. Let's start by opening in prayer. Let's pray. Precious Lord, we thank you, dear Lord, for today. Thank you for the opportunity to meet together in your house in fellowship and to sing praises to you. Lord, we pray now that you'd be exalted by our song. In Jesus' precious name, amen. Please turn with me to 372, Living for Jesus.
Living for Jesus, a life that is true, striving to please Him in all that I do, yielded allegiance, glad-hearted and free. This is the pathway of blessings for me. O Jesus, Lord and Savior, I give myself to Thee, for Thou in Thine atonement didst give Thy love for me. I owe no other master. Heart shall be Thy throne. My life I give henceforth to live, O Christ, for Thee alone. Living for Jesus, who died in my place, buried on Calvary my sin and disgrace. Such love constrains me to answer His call. Follow His leading and give Him my all. O Jesus, Lord and Savior, I give myself to Thee, for Thou in Thine atonement didst give Thyself for me. I owe no other master. My heart shall be Thy throne. My life I give henceforth to live, Lord Christ, for Thee. Living for Jesus wherever I am, doing each duty in His holy name, willing to suffer affliction and loss, deeming each trial a part of my cross. O Jesus, Lord and Savior, I give myself to Thee, for Thou in Thine atonement didst give Thyself for me. I owe no other master. My heart shall be Thy throne. My life I live henceforth to Thee, O Christ, for Thee alone. And the last, living for Jesus, who was living, my dearest treasure, the light of His smile, seeking the lost ones He died to redeem, bringing the weary to find rest in Him. O Jesus, Lord and Savior, I give myself to Thee, for Thou in Thine atonement didst give Thyself for me.
let's turn to Acts chapter 14 for our scripture reading this morning. Acts chapter 14. I was searching all over for my eyeglass cleaner, and it's right here in front of me. Acts chapter 14, starting in verse 8. Acts 14, 8 says, "And there sat a certain Lystra, impotent in his feet, being crippled from his mother's womb, who never had walked. The same heard Paul speak, who steadfastly beholding him, and perceiving that he had faith to be healed, said with a loud voice, Stand up upright on thy feet, and he leaped and walked. And when the people saw what Paul had done, they lifted up their voices, saying in the speech of the Laconian, The gods are come down to us, men. And they called Barnabas Jupiter, and Paul Mercurius, because he was the chief speaker. Then the priest of Jupiter, which was before their city, brought oxen and garland unto the gates, and would have done sacrifice with the people, which when the apostles Barnabas and Paul heard of, they rent their clothes and ran in among the people, crying out and saying, Sirs, why do ye these things? We are also men of like passions with you, and preach unto you that you should turn from these vanities unto the living God, which made heaven and earth, and the sea, and all things that are therein, who in times past suffered all nations to walk in their own ways. He left not them without witness, and that he did good, and gave us rain from heaven, and fruitful seasons, filling our hearts with food and gladness. And with these sayings scarce restrained they the people, that they had not done sacrifice unto them." Let's pray for some of our people that are sick. And a couple updates. Paul is home with a bad toothache. Pray for Paul, and keep praying that Carol's new medicine continues to work with her heart failure. She's got good progress thus far. Saw Mary yesterday. Mary is very eager, wonderful, wonderful attitude. She's much weaker. She's declined. She's lost a lot of strength. She walks from her living room to her kitchen and has to sit down and sometimes falls asleep in the chair. That's only about 30 feet. She's watching right now our recording from last Sunday. She's watching the player. But pray for Mary. Keep her. And she would love a card or a call. Russell is home. He got home Wednesday. I talked with him yesterday. He was having a tough time with digestive problems yesterday, but keep praying for him to be strengthened. He is eager to come back. Yvonne is eager to come back. Yvonne should be out of the rehab by the end of the month. Yvonne, with her new physical limitations, she's moving to the Ransomville trailer park. She needs a ride. You know, she asked me, she says, Pastor, I really miss and I love everybody. Am I going to have to find another church when I'm out, you know, because of location? If somebody's able to help give her rides, please let me know. And we love Yvonne. She's been out for a couple months in the rehab, and so keep praying for her. And my wife is, she's up all night long with a migraine, which is causing nausea. I pray that she has good days. Her MS has been giving her more rough days than good days lately. Okay, let's look to the Lord in prayer. Lord, we thank you, dear Lord, for being the great physician who hears our prayers, who heals, Lord, according to your will. And Lord, we ask on the behalf of brothers and sisters of Christ that you would provide special healing. Lord, we pray that you would be with Paul with his tooth and help it to ease up and the abscess to ease up. Lord, we pray for Carol with her medicine, with her heart failure to do well. Lord, we pray for for Barbara Dill for strength and good days, Lord. Help her to be able to get out and to enjoy some of the fall. Lord, I pray for my wife. Lord, I pray that you would push back the multiple sclerosis. I pray that you'd give her good days. I pray that you would take away the migraine that's kept her up all night and causing her nauseous. Lord, and I pray that you would give her strength enough to get out and to see the fall this year. Lord, we pray for Russell. Thank you and praise you for just the wonderful strength compared to what he had even a month ago. Thank you for restoring that, Lord, and I pray that he's able to come back here with us soon. Lord, thank you that he's home. I pray for Yvonne. As she heals, I pray that she continue to get stronger. And Lord, with her new living situation, we pray that we're able to transport her here. And Lord, we think of Mary. Lord, we pray for Mary Christie for good days. We pray for strength. Praise you for her wonderful attitude, Lord. She's not discouraged with the physical challenges, Lord. And I pray that you would help us to be a comfort and loving to her, Lord, while she's going through this difficulty. Lord, we pray for Joe and Stacy's mom, Terry, as she recovers from her lung operation. Thank you for caring. Thank you for hearing our prayers. In Jesus' precious name, amen. All right. Let's start by singing 580. 580, Jesus loves the little children. And it's a joy to have our kids here in the morning time. We've started going through creation, you know, this morning, talking about in the beginning God. And then the first day, God created light, and it is a joy. Jesus loves the kids. I hope you do. 180.
Jesus loves the little children, all the children of the world. Red and yellow, black, they are precious in his sight. Jesus loves the little children of the world.
And then 238, the King is coming. 238. If you're able, let me encourage you to stand for the next couple just to get the blood flowing. 238. The King is coming. We'll sing this one through twice. I will sing of the mercies of the Lord forever. 457. Hold on, I'm not there yet. It amazes me how quickly he turns the pages. Okay, now hit it.
I will sing of the mercies of the Lord forever. I will sing of the mercies of the Lord forever. I will sing of the mercies. with my mouth will I make known thy faithfulness, thy faithfulness. With my mouth will I make known thy faithfulness to all generations. Sing of the mercies of the Lord, forever I will sing. I will sing. I will sing of the mercies of the Lord, forever I will sing of the mercies of the Lord.
Thank you. You may be seated. All right. Let me direct your attention to our bulletins. Now, let me encourage you to come back this evening at 6:30. As we've been preaching through the book of Hebrews, this evening we'll be looking at God's chastening, the purpose and how we should in Hebrews chapter 12. And after this evening's message, we have our monthly finger food fellowship. It is a good time. You say, you preach shorter on those days. I typically do, yes. Can't guarantee it, but I typically do. But that's our finger food fellowship after our Sunday evening service at 6:30. Welcome. We have a couple visitors, some here and then a couple there, first-time visitors. If you would, there's a little blue card. If you would just fill it out and either put it in the offering plate or hand it to me on the way out, that just gives a record of our visit, and it gives me opportunity to get in touch with you. And so hopefully you'll fill one of those out. Page, we have it's 7 o'clock on Tuesday. We have our ladies fellowship meeting. Let me encourage all the ladies to come out to that. What are you studying now?
Forgiveness.
Studying forgiveness. That's what a wonderful thing to study. That's for the ladies study and fellowship at 7 o'clock. If you would like to help with the food, please just let Barbara know, she'll be glad to have your help with refreshments. And simultaneously, we have our deacons and pastor meeting at the same time. And then all men are invited Saturday morning for breakfast, Saturday at 8:30. Breakfasts have been healthier this summer as we've been trying to work together to lose weight. But that's at 8 o'clock. And then if you're able afterward, we encourage you to stay for some things around the church. Wood splitting, we have a massive amount of wood ready to split, massive amount. And there's other things around the church like replacing light bulbs and stuff. So, men, this Saturday, I encourage you to be here. And then how far are you on your weight loss challenge? We should be at 71%. Now, I think there's 15 people total that said at some point they'll be part of it. We made our own goals. For those that are visiting, we each made our own goals. It was a 17-week challenge. We've completed 12. And my gold challenge, I said if I lose 40 pounds by November 15th, I get a gold medal. If I lose 30, I get a silver. And if I only lose 25, I get a bronze. Now, I got to pick up the pace because right now I'm on a silver medal pace. And each person set their own goals. And I don't want to know, unless you're just eager to tell me, hey, Pastor, I lost so much. I don't want to know what your goal is. But on November 15th, before you come to church, step on the scale and come in and say, hey, I earned a gold, I earned silver. And I will have all we'll get those the week to follow. But it's a fun time. We're just working together, trying to get a little healthier. All right, for our Operation Christmas Child gathering this month, in October, we're collecting toiletries things. Washcloths, combs, brushes, toothbrushes. Not toothpaste, they don't ship that. Deodorants, things like that, bars of soap. And remember, small, compact, because we snacks and a Bible gospel track, and it goes all over the world to encourage boys and girls around Christmas time about Christ. Mowing this week is myself. You say, weren't you the one mowing last week? Yeah, the mower was not cooperating with me. I went to pump up the tires, and the pump died. So we bought a new pump. I pumped up the tires, and I go to start the tractor, and the lawn tractor's dead. It's like, I give up, I'll do it next week. So, still me mowing. And then the thought for the week is, if you follow the Savior, he'll teach you how to fish. Amen. Fisher of men, not salmon during the salmon run. Where's the offering? What's it for? Oh, for me. Ah.
We appreciate you very much.
Well, thank you.
And there's signatures that couldn't be on there.
Well, thank you, everyone. Thank you, brother. The tractor will start now. Do you want me to look in here now or later?
Whatever. You can just pull the top off.
I asked Christopher to bring its battery charger. Now the church got me a battery charger. Amen? Well, praise God. Would you please pray for the offering?
Thank you, dear Lord, for us each and every day. We praise you for your love through Jesus Christ. We thank you for the Word of God and this beautiful building you've provided. Thank you for our visitors, the families that are represented, and we just praise you for our children. We pray that you would open our hearts to the message you have for us, and we thank you for everything in Jesus' name. Amen.
If you're able, let me ask you to stand one more time as we sing 382, 382, Be Thou My Vision. 388? Which one? Oh, okay. I'm trying to clean my glasses and I can't see. I would be like Jesus, 388.
Thank you. Jesus my song, in the home and in the throng. Be like Jesus all day long, I would be like Jesus.
Thank you. You may be seated. Thank you, men. Please turn with me to the book of Galatians. We've been preaching through the book of Galatians. We're in Galatians chapter 4 this week. Last couple weeks we've seen a few comparisons. Comparisons of the law and promise, and comparisons of a servant and sonship. And the wonderful comparisons that God provides in this book to help us to fully understand what is the benefit and the privilege of being saved and being adopted into God's family, and what is the purpose of the law? How much authority does God's law have once we become a child of God? And that's what the book of Galatians focuses mainly on. And now last week we were challenged with the relationship of being adopted children of God. We is a very child of God, joint heirs with Christ, and all taken unimaginable promises, unimaginable privileges. Let's look to the Lord in prayer. We continue in the book of Galatians. We pray that our hearts and minds would just reach to heart, Lord, as we see Paul's exhortation as a loving pastor and apostle or to his people. Lord, we pray that it would inspire and guide us and protect us, Lord, from a hardened heart in the future. Lord, we thank you in Jesus' precious name. Galatians chapter 4, we'll start reading in verse 8. Galatians 4:8 says, "Howbeit then, when ye knew not God, ye did service unto them which by nature are no gods. But now, after that ye have known God, or rather are known, to the weak and beggarly elements, whereunto ye desire again to be in bondage? Ye observe days and months, and times and years. I am afraid of you, lest I have bestowed upon you. Brethren, I beseech you, be as I am, for I am as ye are. Ye have not injured me at all. Ye know how through infirmity of the flesh I preached the gospel unto you at the first. And my temptation which was in my flesh ye despised not, nor rejected, but received me as an angel of God, even as Christ Jesus. Where is then the blessedness ye speak of? For I bear you record, ye would have plucked out your own eye and have given them to me. Therefore become your enemy, because I tell you the truth. They affect you, but not well. Yea, you would exclude; they would exclude you, that ye might affect them. Be zealously affected, always in a good thing, and not only when I am present with you." Provide inside the bulletin an outline, and it's real easy to outline my messages because I try to keep the same format, 3 points, but each with 3 subpoints. I forgot the outline at home today, so I apologize. The 3 points I'll give you, and then you can fill out the subpoints if you're taking notes. Concern for their spiritual condition. The second Roman numeral is concern for Paul's physical condition. And then the third is concern for their emotional condition. So concern for their spiritual condition, concern for Paul's physical condition, for their emotional condition. Today's message is titled, From the Heart of a Pastor. From the Heart of a Pastor. Now technically, he was an apostle. He was a church planner. He was an apostle. It was a special ministry. And there aren't apostles today. They needed a face-to-face commission by Jesus. Jesus was here before he ascended to heaven. And Paul loved his people. Paul loved how God used him. And Paul speaks to them here just like a pastor would, just like a loving minister would. So from the heart of a pastor. And we see concern for their condition. In the first few verses, we see concern for their spiritual conditions. And he starts off, before you knew not God. Before you knew not God. Then, when ye knew not God, ye did service unto them which by nature are no gods. He's saying, understandable that before you came to know God, when you knew not God, it's understandable that you served false gods. The unbeliever, those who have yet to put their trust in Jesus Christ, they don't know God, and they haven't experienced what it means to be experienced God's provision, His presence in their life. They haven't been given life, and they certainly haven't been given assurance of life. They haven't experienced God's care and God's personal love for them. She said, before you knew not God. Howbeit then, when ye knew not God, ye did service unto them by nature. She's saying, look, of course you serve things God. Ye did service unto them which by nature are no gods. Did service. Now we saw last week that the service is referring to how a slave would serve his master. Last week you might remember in Galatians he provided that comparison of a son and a servant. And he's saying, look, you were like a slave. You did whatever was dictated by the master. You were in bondage to rules and regulations. You were in bondage to worship. Before you knew God, you did service unto them which were by nature no gods. Even before they got saved, they said no to know God. They sensed the need to please God. They sensed what was personal with people and that he had requirements for them. And God instills that in them, that God is real and that we're accountable to him. The Galatians here were not atheists. They believed there was God. The Galatians were not agnostics, saying, we have no knowledge of God. Before they came to know God, before they got saved, before Paul came and preached and healed and preached, they served things that weren't God. They served many false gods. Now, history shows they actually served, the Greek were very, very superior. And now the Jews, they would follow Jehovah. The Greeks and the Romans, the Greeks, they would follow Jupiter, Zeus, Apollo, Mercury, all sorts of false gods. We saw in our scripture reading in Acts chapter 14 where Paul and Barnabas came and Paul healed the lame man that was on earth. Paul saw the faith. He heard Paul's preaching. He saw the faith and he said, get up. And he got up and he jumped and he leaped. And after that happened, what did they do? They wanted to come make an offering. They wanted to come bring a blood sacrifice saying, look, the gods have come in person. He's Jupiter and he's Mercurius, Mercury. We see their superstition. Before they knew God, they worshiped things that were not God. This brings to mind when you think about Acts chapter 14, which sets up to the churches of Galatia and the people getting saved in the region. This brings to mind when he goes to Rome, when Paul is at Mars Hill. Acts chapter 17 bears record of that. Acts 17, 22 through 23 says this. Then Paul stood in the midst of Mars Hill and said, ye men of Athens, I perceive that in this all things ye are too superstitious. For as I passed by and beheld your devotions, I found an altar to the unknown God, whom therefore ye ignorantly worship, him I declare unto you. It was their culture to worship and to do service. They had they lifted up as God before ye knew not God. It was logical that you did service and you were in bondage and that they were your masters. But now something's changed. Now things are different. Howbeit, verse 8, howbeit then, when you knew not God, ye did service unto gods. But now, after you have known God, or rather, how turn ye again to the weak and beggarly elements? It's understandable that they served false gods or served things that weren't God before. Before you knew not God, but now you know God. Now you know God. And he asked the question, whereunto ye desire to be in bondage? But now, take a look at your present life. And you go back 2,000 years ago, as Paul is addressing the Judaizers have come in, and he says, you used to serve, you used to be in bondage when you didn't know God, but now, in your present life, not only do you know God, but you're known of God. But now, after that ye have known God, or rather that you are known of God, he says, speaking beggarly, it's such a privilege for us to have the relationship that he spoke of in the previous verses. The privilege to be called the sons of God, the privilege to be adopted into God's family, to be made joint heirs, to call him Abba Father, Daddy Daddy. How is it that now that you have this relationship, now that you know God and he knows you, and you have, are you focused on those weak and beggarly elements? Weak and beggarly elements. He's saying, look, do you desire to be in bondage again? It's kind of like the picture of someone who struggles, who the cycle of addiction to drugs. They get all cleaned up. They get a new life. They get out of prison. They restore the relationships. They get to know God, but after a while, they return to that addiction. Well, here we see their religiosity, their ritual, their desire to do religious works or observances was what they were addicted to. Now, people get addicted to different things. But now that he said, why? Now that you have the relationship, now that you know God, why are you serving these beggarly items? Why are you looking to in bondage yourself with the law or legalism? This is perplexing to Paul. Before, you didn't know better. Now you know better. Why would one freed from slavery want to return to slavery? It doesn't make any sense. How turn ye again, verse 9, to the weak and beggarly items whereunto ye desire to be in bondage? Notice here the weak and beggarly elements that he refers to. Well, here the law is weak. We saw a couple weeks ago that the law is perfect. The law is God's law. Not only the Ten Commandments, but all the 13 commandments of God. But you cannot be justified by deeds of the law, shall no man be justified. The power of the law is to convince man of their sin, to convince man of their hopelessness to keep God's standard. And because they realize that they can't keep it, they need to turn to faith in Christ, who was a perfect sacrifice, who died as a substitute. And now he's saying, why are you turning? Why are you bondaging? Why are you becoming a slave to the weak elements? The law is weak in that it cannot save. It's perfect. It's wonderful. It's God's word. It's God's law. But it is weak in that it can redeem. It can save no man. All it has the power to do is to put men under the curse of the law, to condemn men. The law is beggarly. Beggarly. You say, what is use? How turn ye again to the elements. Bagley, what it means is it provides no use in man's attempt to be right before God. They can't become right by deeds of the law. By deeds of the law shall not be justified. We saw in Galatians 2:21, I do not frustrate. Does righteousness come by the law? If righteousness has come by the law, then Christ is dead in vain. Get the idea when he's slowly and painstakingly taking the time to establish in their mind what justifies and what the relation is, and how people get caught up in tradition and religion and start serving the religion rather than the tradition. I get the idea of my mechanic. You'd say, what do you mean? Well, pause with me. Jeffrey's Auto Repair, his name is Timothy. Confuses me all the time. But it's Jeffrey Auto Repair. His name's Timothy. Stephen knows who I'm talking about. Well, you go there, and he's got tools. He's got a car lift. He's got different wrenches. He's got hammers. He likes his hammers. I even see him use a pry bar on my car before to adjust the muffler. He's got all sorts of tools. The tools are effective, each and every tool. I mean, when a guy that likes tools gets around tools, you go, I mean, it's just something inside us. Now, one of his tools, which is very effective, takes tire off just like that. So, yeah, I wish I had one of those. I would never use it, but it'd be fun to have. Well, the idea is, okay, the wrench is a tool that gives him the ability to fix the car, but the end goal is to drive in the car, to repair the car, to get it. How out of place, how wrong would it be for him to put all his focus, all his attention on the wrench and neglect the car? Every day he shines his wrench up, puts all the sockets in the place, makes sure the pump is oiled up, and spends on the air wrench and the pump and neglects the car in front of him. That's the point here. He's saying, look, why are you focused on that one thing? The purpose of it was to bring you to Christ, not to make you righteous, but to cause you to realize your need for Christ. Before you knew not God, now ye know God. And thirdly, why do you serve things not God? Why do you serve things, not God? Verse 10. Ye observe days and months and times and years. He's saying, look, you're very religious. Now, all of these refer to Judaism. Within the law, there's instructions to observe certain days, the Sabbath of each week, months, the different feasts, the years, which year are the seventh. So the whole the days, the Sabbaths and the high holy days, the high Sabbaths, the months, the festival of the new moon, the atonement, the feast of the times, Yom Kippur, the Day of Atonement, the Feast of Tabernacles, Feast of Unleavened Bread, the Feast of Pesach, the Sukkot, the Creating Shelter, the Feast of Tabernacles. Ironically enough, the Jews were, the Judaizers, not the Jews, the Judaizers, those who had crept into the Galatian churches and say, not only are you saved by grace through faith, but in order to complete your salvation, you need to also observe, you need to be circumcised, and you need to observe these areas of the law. All of these areas that they're saying observe pointed ahead to Christ. I don't know about you, but for those of us who were in the adult Sunday school class, really enjoyed this study. Watch how each one pointed ahead to the Messiah, pointed ahead to Christ, when he would come, how he would come, why he would come, in what manner and what it symbolized and how to be prepared for. These feasts and days and months and years that he's saying about, they showed that he would for all. That he would come and that he would break the veil of separation between God and man. They show that Jesus Christ and his righteousness would be the shelter that covers man, that he would give men free, that he would take freedom. He would take away our sin. Look at verse 11. I am afraid of you, lest I have bestowed upon you labor in vain. He's saying, I'm concerned for your souls. Concerned for your souls. Paul fears that one of the worst things that's happened to the church, to the churches of Galatia, the instrument that he was involved in planting. He's saying, look, my labor in establishing the Bible-believing, Bible-preaching Baptist churches, he says, I'm concerned that the church has grown cold towards the gospel, that they're no longer preaching the gospel of Christ. I'm afraid of you, lest I have bestowed. Galatians 5:4, he says it this way. Christ has become of none effect unto you. Whosoever of you are justified by the law, ye are fallen from grace. As he's addressing the Judaizers, he says, look, all of those that think you're justified by the law, by works of the law, you're not saved by grace. You're not truly saved. A pastor's heart melts when he sees the people of his flock addicted to things other than things that build the relationship with God. My heart melts if I'd see someone addicted to pride or praise or be addicted to or lust or money and work. Here, Paul's heart's melting. Wow, you're getting addicted to religion. Albert Barnes, one commentator, writes this: what pastor has not often had such fears of his people? Turn to the weak and beggarly elements of the world, or when, after having run well, he sees them become the slaves of fashion, or of some habit inconsistent with the simplicity of the gospel. Whether physical or emotional or spiritual addictions, here we see that are heavy on his heart. So we see, first of all, with from the heart of a pastor, concern for their spiritual condition. Now we move on to physical condition. Concern for his physical condition. Verse 12, he says, brethren, I beseech you, be as I am, as ye are. Ye have not injured me at all. Well, first thing with 12 and 13, I deeply care for you. Concern for his physical condition starts off, look, I deeply care for you. He says, brethren, he's not treating them as apostates. He's not treating them as back. He's treating others. Look, I treat you as family. Brethren, I beseech you. Now, as an apostle, he has the authority to command. I command you to do this. He doesn't command. He's beseeching. He's pleading with them. He's begging them out of his heart. The heart of a true minister. Please don't do this. I beseech you, brethren. I'm loving you. Love me as I love you. Brethren, I beseech you, be as I am. He's saying, look, I love and I care for you. Do the same towards me. Don't turn against me. Don't turn against the ministry. Rather, love me as I love you. For I am as ye are. Ye have not injured me at all. Now, it's interesting. You know, I've been pastoring, I guess, for close to 25 years now. When somebody becomes backslidden, typically what they do is they take guilt. They and they... 9 times out of 10, they focus it on the pastor. You say, why? Because he's the one preaching the Word of God. And the Word of God is stepping on their toes. And if they can discredit the thing, then they can get out of church. So many times I've knocked on the door, and, oh yeah, I'm saved. You go to church? No, I haven't been to church for years. Why? Well, the pastor. How many times did we hear that on door-to-door, Jackie? when they blame a pastor for dying. Well, the pastor that I love passed away, and I don't click with a new pastor so much. Well, so many times, you know, that a backslidden person, they will alienate themselves from the pastor, and they want little to do with God, so they turn away from God, they turn away from the pastor. A backslidden person will often attack a pastor's character. Dr. Fred Schindler, he was the pastor of Lancaster. He was the president of Northeast Baptist School of Theology, and he says, "Men," this is preacher boy, he says, "Men, if I could take off my spiritual shirt, you would see all the scars." And he says, "The scars from God's people." As they would stab in the back, and he was talking about being a minister of God, how God's people were the ones that caused the hurt. It was not Satan, not the devil, but God's people. Pastor Cunningham, my mentor. Oh, I can't wait to see Pastor Cunningham in glory. I think the rapture will happen soon. I'll stand before him. I'll look out for Pastor Cunningham. Pastor Cunningham, I'll never forget Pastor come in one day from bus visitation. Spent several hours excited about all the doors I knocked on, and he's just crying. "What's wrong, Pastor?" It took me a while to pry it out of it. He's crying because somebody left the church and said they left because he doesn't love me. I have never met, not exaggeration, I have never met a more loving pastor in my life than Pastor. There's a lot of times that I often pray, and I've prayed hundreds of times, "God, make me more loving him." And I'm not talking about the overwhelming belly. That's just God's humor. Or me not pushing the food away. I don't know. It's when I say, "Make me more like Pastor Cunningham," I say, "God, make me more caring and compassionate like Pastor Cunningham." When I pray that, there's a little bit of intimidation there. You say, "Why?" Because I know what causes one to be compassionate and loving and caring. It's breaking. Pastor Cunningham was broken a lot. I don't want more breaking, but I want to be more loving. I want to be a better servant of Christ. Think of Gary Gilbert. Gary Gilbert, another pastor friend of mine, he was preaching one day, and he took off his suit jacket. I thought about doing this today, and I was like, "No, I don't have a shirt to waste." He took off his suit jacket, and behind, whoops, I got my microphone attached here. Behind, his shirt was shredded. He was talking about how as a pastor, that there's so many things that come and cut us up, and that we cover with our ministerial clothes, God's men have scars from God's people. God's people here were harming. They were harming his heart. Despite he clearly loves them. He has affection for them and kindness with them. And he says in verse 12, he's saying, "Look, listen to me, because I'm a..." And I was zealously addicted to serving religion. He says, "I know all the ceremonies. I kept all the ceremonies." Elsewhere, he says, "If anybody has confidence in the flesh, I more so." He says, "I am as ye. I know what it's like, but I'm saved now. I am a Jew. I know all the religious rites, but I'm saved now. Ye have not injured me at all." Now, his heart was hurting for them. But what he's saying, "When you have not injured me at all," he wasn't saying that. He's saying, "You haven't injured my standing with God at all. My relationship with God isn't contingent on your relationship with God. You haven't done any injury to me. I'm still redeemed. I'm still justified. I'm still called to serve despite all the circumstances in life." You're only injuring yourself. I'm begging you, return to him for whom you're revolting. This is the plea. He's saying, look, I care for you. I deeply care for you. Verse 13. You know how through infirmity of the flesh I preached the gospel unto you at first? To Paul's infirmity of the flesh. We don't know exactly what it is. It would certainly indicate his eyes. It would certainly indicate he had trouble seeing. He had some bodily weakness, we know at least with his vision, and likely to a despicable outward appearance. We know this. 1 Corinthians 2 says this. 1 Corinthians 2, 3 through 5 says, and I was with you in weakness and in fear and in much trembling. Each of my preaching was not with enticing words of man's wisdom, but in demonstration of the Spirit and power, that your faith should not stand in the wisdom of men, but in the power of God. Paul deeply cared for people that he wouldn't let his infirmities stand in the way and keep him from preaching God's word. So he starts off, I deeply care for concern for his physical condition. Next we see, you received me as I was. You received me as I was. Verse 14. And my temptation, which was in my flesh, ye despised not, nor rejected, but received me as an angel of God, even as Christ Jesus. Paul's taken aback. He says, as I deeply loved you, and I received me as I was. I was pretty pathetic looking. When I first came to you, you didn't question my message. You received me. You were very, despite my outward appearance, you looked beyond my outward appearance, the obvious ailment, and you looked at me as a messenger from God, despite my ailment. And my temptation, which is in my flesh, you despised not, nor rejected, but received me as an angel or messenger of God, even as in Christ Jesus. Illustration of this is myself. When I was pastoring Tri-State Baptist Church, not many of you know this part of my life. It was the first church I solo pastored, and they asked me, Pastor Evander, would you come pastor us while we close? Now my mind is picturing that this church would revive and go on, but they had 1 year left on their lease. They were $40,000 in debt. They wanted to finish out their lease. They didn't want to leave debt. They wanted all that cleaned up. And there's a small body of believers, 20 believers. And they said, would you pastor us? It was a wonderful year. And through that, every single family had major loss. Not just one, every one of us. Ability to walk. Multiple sclerosis progression. And she lost the ability to play the piano. One guy lost his wife. Two people lost their parents. One lost their child. And let me tell you, this was a group of broken people. We were leaning one on one another. We were codependent. We were hurting and healing one another as a church. And it was when it was time to close, when the year was up. Well, but we paid off the debt. You say, what's the example? Okay. I went on vacation. My family and I went on vacation. And I woke up in the morning having experienced Bell's palsy. Now, if you don't know what Bell's palsy is, half the face loses all movement. Even when I smile today, one's a little higher than the other. My eyes aren't symmetrical. But it's not bad now. When I had it, I was terribly embarrassed. My eye at night, I had to tape shut, because if I didn't, it would get so crazy. Sand in, because I couldn't smile. If I took a drink, I had to hold my lips shut. While I was talking or not paying attention, drool, and I'd have no idea the drool was coming down. This happened on vacation. So I couldn't go to the neurologist, and I wasn't going to stop vacation to go to the hospital. Didn't go to the neurologist to get steroids, which you need to treat right away with. If you wait too long, it's an effect. So I got back. The hardest time it ever got for me to preach was coming back that week. Satan was all over me all week long, and there was this need call it off. Just tell him you're not up to preaching today. Tell him you're sick. And he says, you received me as I was. I remember when I got up to preach that week and constantly wiping off drool and clothes and blinking my eye through the tie manually, because that is the most receptive I've ever had a preaching service. Everyone that was there came forward to the altar and got right with God. That is something a pastor dreams of. And here Paul is saying, look, I was looking pretty pathetic and I was pretty sad. You look beyond that. You received me as God's messenger and you received the message. You received me as I was. Thirdly, you deeply cared for me. I deeply cared for you. You received me as I was. You deeply cared for me. Verse 15. Where is then the blessedness you speak of? For I bear you record that if it had been possible, you plucked out your own eye and given them to me. Where's the blessedness that you speak of? He's saying, look, happy you were when you received the gospel, when you received Jesus as your Savior. For I bear you record. I bear you record. He says, look, I'm giving testimony of how receptive you were. There was no lack of your receiving, hearing for me as a man of God. I bear you record that if it had been possible, you'd have plucked out your own eyes. He's saying, look, if you were able, you would have pulled out your own eyes and given to me. That's how receptive, that's how loving, that's how caring you were. I should say, they'll often do the work despite illness, physical struggles, despite mental struggles, despite emotional afflictions of the flesh. Most of the time, and a God won't even let the people know what the afflictions are unless they need to call on prayer. You say, why? Because in so many churches, God takes our prayer request and causes an occasion to be dissatisfied with the pastor, to cause division, to cause a split. So you say, who do pastors get to pray for them? Usually, other pastors. It's truth. So Paul is appealing to them. He's saying, look, now have the same spirit of receptivity that you had. God's people ought to be receptive to the men of God and to the message of God from God's word. When Paul sent Epaphroditus back to Philippi, he had to correct the churches about the servant of Christ. In Philippians 29 through 30, it says this, receive him therefore in the Lord with all gladness, and hold such in reputation, because for the work of Christ he was nigh unto death, not regarding his service towards me. What he's saying is, quit talking bad about Epaphroditus. Epaphroditus, the reason why you haven't heard him is he's been faithfully serving and doing what you yourself couldn't do, to the point of almost dying. It's sad when churches turn against and abandon their pastor when they become stricken in their body or spirit. The churches of Galatia, they received Paul with joy, even when he was suffering affliction. So far from the heart of a pastor, we've seen concern for their spiritual condition, spiritual, or for his physical condition, and then thirdly, concern for their emotional. Now, before we get into the you can see when people aren't receptive. Thankfully, as I say that, I don't see any right now. But usually there's some physical image, you know. People cross their arms. That's a telltale sign. Just try to bless me. Or my favorite, because I'm such a short-winded preacher. I've seen that a couple thousand times over the years. There are signs when someone is not being receptive. They have the attitude, bless me, I'm not going to listen to you. I'm going to listen to bits and words, and I'm... They just have that. My page blue. They have the hardened heart. They don't want to be told good no matter what. When they get told the word of God and it steps on their toes, what do they want to do? They want to blame the pastor more often than not. Let me catch up here. So he says, your heart has become hardened. I'm concerned about you, concerned for their emotional condition. Your heart has become hardened. Verse 16, am I therefore become your enemy because I tell you the truth? He just got done saying, look, you were so concerned for my physical condition. When I came and I loved and I shared the gospel, you received me. You looked beyond my physical ailments. You were ready to pluck out your own eyes, fully on board with me. But now, your heart is so hard and unreceptive. Am I therefore become your enemy? How is it that your attitude has changed so? You used to love me with the most fervent of affections. Your heart is hardened towards the truth. You loathe me. It says, am I therefore become your enemy? He says, you loathe me so much that you count me as an enemy. Why? Because I tell you the truth. Because I tell you the truth. Now, as children of God, as those that are saved, we should welcome the truth of the Word of God. The difficulty of the truth, the difficulty of Bible preaching, is that it reveals our flaws. It reveals the areas of sin and iniquity in our life that we need to work on. Don't want to hear that. There's a, I'll call him an apostate, a very well-known Joel Osteen, does not preach the truth. In an interview, they ask, how are you so popular? How is it that 23 million people call you their pastor? And he says, I don't preach the bad things. I only preach the good things. That's not the counsel of God. We're to reprove, rebuke, exhort with all patience and long-suffering. We're to preach the whole counsel. It reveals our flaws. Well, we should welcome the truth despite that. Now, understand the men of God that preach the Word of God, there's not one of them without many flaws. Now, you may not know how many flaws I have. You may not know my flaws. But every time I get into God's Word, every time I study, every time I prepare for a message, and this applies for any spiritually sensitive man of God, God is working on their heart, revealing you need to work in this area. You need to be more dedicated in this. You need to be yet less yielded in this. So before I get up and preach to you, God has been working on my heart all week long about this. There's a continuous process of getting things right because of the truth in the life of a believer. So understand, when a preacher hits you with the truth of the Word, you say, I don't like what he's saying because it's stepping on my toes. It's already stepped on his toes repeatedly. Well, the Galatians started getting bent out of shape on his second missionary journey. Galatians 2:14, he referred to this. They walk not uprightly according to the truth of the gospel. I said unto Peter before them all, if thou, being a Jew, livest after the manner of the Gentiles, and not as a Jew, why compellest thou the Gentiles to live as do the Jews? Now, the truth often confronts and exposes the flaws in our character. And Paul confronted Peter, and Paul confronted Barnabas, who was being drawn away, and they received it. They saw the correction and the logic of the Word of God. Judaizers, they didn't receive the truth. They became antagonistic, and they started directing their influence and directing their teaching against Paul. Your heart has become hardened. Next we see you're zealous for the wrong things. You're zealous for the wrong things. 17. They zealously affected you, but not well. They exclude you that ye might affect them. They. Who are they? The Judaizers. The Judaizers, those who are teaching that you need the works and faith. Zealously affected you. They show that they have an extraordinarily strong regard. They moved you to believe it, but not well. They zealously affected you, but not well. What does this mean? Is there a zeal isn't according to the knowledge of the Word of God? They aren't focused on your benefits, rather they're focused on, and they're not focused on your standing with God. Yes, they would what it's saying is, look, they would exclude me from you. They would exclude you from the gospel and knowing more about the gospel that you might affect them. And say, look, they're doing it for their benefit. They love the esteem. They love the position. They love God and the authority. When someone's heart becomes hardened to the truth, they become easy prey for pray for those that would scratch behind their ears. The Bible tells us about our time now as Paul writes to Timothy in 2 Timothy 4, 3-4. For the time will come when they will not endure sound doctrine, but after their own lust shall they heap to themselves teachers having itching ears. And they shall turn away their ears from the truth and shall be turned unto fables. We as believers, we need to make sure that we're following a preaching man of God. Make sure that we're not following one that isn't proclaiming God's word. We need to make it a purpose for our entire life. Don't mess with teachers, false teachers. Matthew 15:14, Jesus says this, let them alone. They be blind leaders of the blind, and if the blind lead the blind, both shall fall into a ditch. Zeal itself isn't bad. He says, you're zealous for the wrong thing. Zeal needs the right purpose. Religious zeal can be good or it can be bad depending on the purpose, which leads to the third and final subpoint. Be zealous about the good things. Be zealous about the good things. Look at verse 18 as we close. It says, zealously affected, always in a good thing, and not only when I am present with you. So although zeal can be done over the bad things, it can be condemned, it could also be just and right. It could be praise. A relationship zeal, one that's right with God's word. We should be zealous over God's word. We should be zealous over. He says, always a good thing, and not only when I am present with you. He's saying, look, you should be zealous about the truth and your relationship with God, and not just while I'm there. You get the idea. It's like talking to teenagers. We don't have any teenagers in here today. It's like talking to teenagers. One week they are just in love. Love. Oh, I can't live without them. This week, I'm in love with someone else. He's saying, look, be zealous, be fervent, be on fire for the things that I'm saying, but not only when I'm there, stick with them. Another display of apathy. It's not covered, or never. And heart is apathy. It's not covered in this passage. But they come to church and they'll just go through the motions and they're not moved. They're not moved with the love of God. They're not moved with the and I picture that in Revelation 3:14-15. He talks to the church of Laodicea, Jesus, and he says, I know thy works, that thou art neither cold nor hot. I would that thou wert cold thou art lukewarm and neither cold nor hot, I will spew thee out of my mouth. We shouldn't be apathetic. We should be zealous over God's wonderful promises. We're instructed in 1 Thessalonians 5:21, prove all things, hold fast to that which is good. We need to apply it according to God's word. Cling to that which is good. When we learn truth, we need to cling to it, embrace it, let it adjust us, and let our minds just be shaped by it. As the men come, let me tell you, as your pastor, I can relate today. When it says, you know, when I put the title from the heart of your pastor, I can say from the heart of your pastor, I can relate his care. I don't want to see anyone in here serving the wrong things. I don't want to see you serving the wrong things. Don't want to see you giving your life to earn more money, or giving your life for pride, for more applause. I don't want to see you in bondage to the addiction of lust or even tradition. Or certainly this year, President, your life is more important than politics. You could really be into politics, but I don't want to see you serving your life away on politics. I want you to be focused on the things that are right, not focused on the wrong things, becoming hard to the things of God. Maybe you're here today and you've let your heart become a little distracted. Things. You've become a little hardened. Let me tell you, you go down that road, if your heart continues to be hardened, you'll miss out on so much. You really will. And we as a body of believers, as a church, will miss out on much. If God is poking your heart right now, saying, hard problem, hardened heart, need to recommit right now. You can do that in your pews while we sing. I encourage you to come set it at the altar. Special about coming to the altar. And then lastly, if you're here today and you haven't received Jesus as your Savior, or if you're listening to it via the internet at home and you haven't, don't put it off any longer. Don't be separated from God. Turn to Him. Look to Jesus. Ask Jesus to come into your heart, to be your Lord and Savior. If you're here today and you haven't been saved, let me encourage you to just come and say, Pastor, I need to talk with someone. As we close, let me ask us to sing 364. If you're able to stand, please stand and respond however God would have you to respond. 364, My Jesus, I Love Thee.
My Jesus, I love thee.